So, I wanted to introduce myself. I'm Alessandro Volpato, master's biologist, biotech innovator, and someone calls me biohacker because I'm involved into this movement of do-it-yourself biology. It's kind of self-initiating projects and taking on scientific research. I'm based in Berlin and we have a community, like tiny community lab, and we are collaborating with several partners. We are building, for example, mushroom materials. We teach people how to do it, or we do experiments with bacteria producing sand or more or pushing forward eco-sustainability. Okay, today it's about using a Pocket Science Lab as platform to design scientific equipment. This is important to us. I'm a biologist. I don't have an electronic engineer setup and background. And for me, it's really important to have access to these tools. And for this reason, I learned how to program, how to a little bit to design electronic circuits to build open source scientific equipment that can be used to teach how science is done in the laboratories and to involve citizens and curious and individuals into research and tackling, for example, ecological sustainability together and push them and find a solution together. Okay, so because we may have an audience comes from biology and not from tech, I will quickly explain what is a microcontroller. It's a tiny computing unit that is used for simple tasks, embedded systems, they are called. For example, you have it one in the car, is the computer that when you push the button turns on the radio or raises your window. You don't need a full-scale computer for that, but a tiny computing unit will do the task. So, how does the microcontroller scene look like? So, in 1971, the microcontroller units look like the tiny element in the red circle. And that was the technology. In the year 2006, found on Hackaday, it's a circuit board to drive a radio commanded truck, tiny one, a toy. And hobbies are playing around with this technology just as a learning experience. And this kept going. Because it was so useful that also biologists started to prototype and to play around with microcontrollers and technologies. This is an event in Berlin, which is Science Hack Day, where science enthusiasts come together and hack on science topics and projects for a whole weekend. This is an experiment where a biologist automated a system to push evolution in yeast and microbes to let them eat and degrade plastics. The cool thing is that, so the main question is how can you use computers and controllers to read life parameters or the parameters of living beings? How can you digitize even such a thing? And how can you teach a computer how to interact with a living being and giving in what he needs? And yes, so we are talking about digitization and what's going on. So in the tech environment, first we make good use of steam of motors, and that was enabling set up a mass production environment where we could produce a lot of our products, and adding some automation to it enabled us to get where we are right now, where a lot of products are being produced and sold. But we are still pushing for digitization, because now we are with our phone devices and all the technology that we have, we are producing a lot of data, which is stored in, because we saw that in 2010, we hit the point where there was practically all the information that we store it digitally. So not more on the paper, but on a computer. And the computer is able to read what our needs are. And if computer can communicate with a production tool in the industries, it's possible to produce services and products on demand. So yes, this is the direction and the trend that the industry is taking. And what about biology? We started to digitize living beings. So digitization is the process of converting information into computer readable format. How do you put so yourself into a digital format? This is a tiny tool which is called Min Ion Sequencer. It's a DNA reader. It's a device that's used to read your code, your blueprint. So the DNA is simply a code, a blueprint to build an organism, to build a human, to build a bacteria, to build a plant. And it's a code. You can, my genetic code. I can sequence myself and read the action of to build myself. And on the right, we can see how does it look like, this genetic code. And you can imagine it's like the programming code, the source code of a program. There are parts that are instructions, there are parts that are text, there are loops, there are executables, there are things that don't have to be executed, things that has to be executed under certain conditions. And yes, this is how we interpret now living beings, digitized living beings. And what about open source? Because this is a proprietary device, but how are we going on with open source and with democratizing these techniques and methods? On the left, we can see the Opentrons, which is a petting robot. In a biology lab, the work of a biologist is mainly pipetting tiny amounts of liquids from one vial, one tiny tube, to the next one, cooling and mixing and splitting. And this is basically what a biologist does in the lab the whole time, which is a pity, because he could use its time in a much more efficient way. For this, pipetting robots have been built. This open source robot, which usually costs $100 to $500,000. Yes, it is an amazing. Yeah, it's fun and amazing at the same time. And this version, this open source version, costs around $5,000. And this is amazing because it was used in the coronavirus and COVID crisis, and it's still used to extract the viral protein. The tiny elements that compose the virus, it's possible to extract them and prepare them with the robot, which speeds up a lot what has to be done. And I will share my screen now. And show you what's the next. How do I knew how to do it? Well,
You should have a button to share your screen on the next to the camera.
Yes, share your screen. It doesn't only share. Yes, I gave allowance. No.
Yeah, let me try to give you the presenter rights again.
Okay. Because it's stopping me. Okay, so I will do in a different way. So please wait 1 second. I will share with you the video. I see here share an external video and okay. Let's see if it's working. Yes, great. And this is the new way that in which Open is tackling and to. Yes, you have to click to play. Please. And yes, so we won't pipette around anymore, but we are already able to move liquids into electrical fields. And here is a device, OpenDrop, is open source from a partner of mine, which is Urs Gaudenz at Gaudi Labs. And you can see how liquids are moved, which is extremely cool. You can imagine you have the reagents of an experiment in these tiny droplets. And there are some parts of this chessboard, parts, cooling parts, or simply analytics source. But at this time, we don't have any sensor connected to it. And so we are in the process of developing this integration of sensors within this board. So. Yes. So I will make my presentation. Now, how do I get out of here?
Can go back with the action button.
Okay, here, this one. Nope. Oh, sorry, guys. Keyboard and meeting logout. Share your screen.
There you go.
And done. Whoa. Okay, we are on the
Yep.
Can you see the presentation? Yes or no? I don't see the chat anymore. Okay, great.
Yes, we can see the presentation.
Yes. So we saw how is developed the situation developing into the open source environment. And now we can have a glimpse in the future. How does it work? On the left side, we see this Promethe ion. This is the device, so the tiny device that I showed you to read the DNA. This machine is able to handle 48 units of that. To handle such an amount of data, the three boxes that you see are computers just to handle this amount of data. And this is a machine that will play a major role in the future of biology because it will enable us to read, to extract a lot of information from the microbes that are around us, from the microbes that are in the environment, for example, in an hospital, which kind of antibiotic resistant bacteria there are in such in which room and how they are evolving, or where you can monitor all the pests on a crop and know exactly where to intervene to have pest control reactions and in the very beginning. Now I will show you through. I will share the link with you again for the next video. This is. Okay, we learned how to share the video. Let's see if I will be able to come back then. This is the OpenDrop bioserver, if you click on the link, and you will see how we put together in an open source way this device that was able to move the droplets. And you can think about each of these robots being a technician in the lab that is running an experiment. And you can see how you can parallelize experiments and have, in this case, 8 lab technicians working in your lab. And this is a box of the dimension of smaller than a baking oven that you have at home. And this is being digitized and how this revolution is impacting the laboratories. And this is what scientists are in a deep need of getting in touch with open source designing communities, because the pace of an oven, yes, a bake oven, like something that you have at home, yep. So I learned, I do like this and confirm. Okay, great. We learned how to come back. this is the future of lab automation, and open source is catching up at a really fast pace. And we can, if we manage to work together between scientists and developers, we can have a really collaborative research environment. Can you imagine how much data can you share if the data is taken by a sensor or by a robot? And you can really make biology reproducible, because you simply have a program to run an app to run on your bioserver, or simply insert the reagents and the experiment will run on its own and share with you the data online. So yes, this is the future of the biology. And this is the actual challenge, how to integrate all these quality sensors that are around into the microcontrollers. Things like the Pocket Science Lab or Arduino, or using this controller as the computing core of these sensors. The sensor that are used in the laboratories are not different from the one that we are using when we learn Arduino. It's not different than a light sensor. There is no difference than a thermometer, a temperature sensor, the humidity sensor. These are all common sensors that are found in many lab devices. And from an engineer perspective, there is nothing extremely difficult to build. It's just the quality of the sensor. I will go more in depth into this bioserver later on, Shang, so that in the Q&A, because it's a topic on its own. And so everything is about integrating data acquisition on these automated platforms. I will make you a practical example, because maybe it's too abstract. Spectroscopy in the laboratory. Okay, now you're not an expert, so I will tell you in cheap words what we are doing in the laboratories. Spectroscopy is simply the study of the interaction between light and matter. Let's say, whoa. What are the applications? Let's go for applications so that you can understand if you can study the light, what can you get, which kind of information can you get out of it. We are using this spectroscopy to measure different compounds in the food, for example, to find toxic compounds in the blood, to check water quality, if it's drinkable, and how can it be dangerous, to check for heavy metals, for example, or for other organic pollutants that are dangerous to our health. In pharmacy, it's used to check the purity. Yes, exactly, rainbow science. In pharmacy, it's checked to use the to check the purity of the medicinal compounds. So how clean is a drug, for example, medicament, or to determine how stars, so what stars in the sky are made of. So it's really, there is a lot of opportunities with this spectroscopy. And so you can imagine that I met Mario Belling, and we said, I asked him, what can you build on with PS? What can you do with Pocket Science Lab? I'm a scientist, I don't know anything about microcontrollers. And he told me, well, you can use sensors and connect it to your phone. We have apps and a lot of different things. There is an oscilloscope, there is a multimeter, a wave generator, logic analyzers, and much more is getting added, like robotic controls, digital instruments. And I said, and he asked me, what do you plan, what could you do with it? And I said, okay, I want to do spectroscopy with it. And so spectro what? Because he's not on the biologist side. And I told him, yes, by connecting a spectrometer with PS Lab, you will be able to analyze food compounds, water quality, medicinal substances, and doing biology and chemistry research, and even check what stars are made of. I said, okay. He said, cool, let's do it. And this is why I'm here. And so we are trying to integrate these biology sensors into Pocket Science Lab, it as a computer for a microcontroller for laboratory devices, and make these devices work on your phone or on controller. CCD sensor is the future of light sensors. This device, this sensor has 3,600 singular light sensor in it, and really powerful to measure what we want to measure, the rainbow that we want to measure. So the spectrum, it's called in science. And each pixel will measure a different color, let's say so. And here is what we did. We, on the left, from the left to the right, we prototyped on a breadboard sensor, and how this driver circuit board for the sensor. and we make it run on the Nucleo, which is an industrial microcontroller for prototyping. Then we took the circuit board and we baked and assembled all the tiny parts that are needed to make it run. And with Daniel Vesolek, we made it run, and you see that the sensor is working on microcontrollers. And so the... we build a GitHub repository so that other people can collaborate with us. Although it's a really early stage, so we still have to enable collaboration in the development, but we are working in this direction to make allow everyone to collaborate. And what's coming next, our to-do list, is yes, to connect first this sensor with the Pocket Science Lab and get some reads out of it. We need to design a case for the sensor, because so on the top left you see the schematics, the 3D schematics of my old spectrometer, and on the bottom you see something new, how I'm prototyping the new case and setup that allows the new sensor to be integrated. We have to make it work, and in the very end we have to share tutorials about how you can analyze, for example, plant compounds. And when you learn how to analyze plant compounds, then you learn also how to analyze food or pharmaceuticals. So it's a really powerful tool, or water, if you have it and know how to use it. And so the vision is to automate spectroscopy in these open source devices. I will be sharing with you the next video. And this is what I'm, another of my projects. I'm producing a transparent microfluidic support to move, to make the support, the board transparent, so that light can pass through it and we can analyze the colors or the optical properties of the droplets moving on the device. And this is a transparent printed circuit board. And yes, this is my idea. This is why I'm doing an open source spectrometer, to automate the reads on the on the automated platform. And yes, this is what I hope to do in the middle future. So. This is another topic on its own, and this is cool because it allows a really tiny amount of liquid to be moved. Okay, now I'm back to my presentation. And it would be nice if with Pocket Science Lab we would manage to integrate this sensing technology on this microfluidics device, on this on this open drop. And so this can happen for many more devices. This is so Gaudi Labs is producing a lot of scientific laboratory open source devices. It would be extremely cool if instead of connecting to a computer, you could connect it to the FOSS Asia Pocket Science Lab and to your smartphone, and to share data directly. And in the same way, you can connect a sensor to the Pocket Science Lab, you can do the work the other way around. You can have a Pocket Science Lab as a platform to share more. For example, you can use it to retrieve data and to collect it in a, we call it in a laboratory logbook. this is where the scientists store and record all the records of the experiments. It was done on the paper. Nowadays, there are already apps to organize your data and the results of your experiments. And this is cool because it allows the whole team to have an overview of how the whole team is working, or to have a direct direct access to every data produced by the scientists working on experiments. So it's that's the future of biology, sharing, digitizing. And in the very end, if you have a lot of data that is produced and stored in a structured way, you can also run machine learning and allow a computer to have its say on the intellectual work of a scientist. So yes, we can integrate machine learning. If you imagine to have a shared logbook in a laboratory, you can imagine also to have more laboratories sharing their logbooks. So you can exchange between among scientists. Yes, it's almost to the end. I'm close to the end. Don't worry, Marco. And you can help standardize reagents, instruments, and so that you have comparable results and reproducible protocols. And you can enable community research on a world scale and data sharing. And this is in an open source environment, this will be extremely powerful. And on top of it, you can the coolest thing is that you can enable a marketplace where robotization enables lowers the skill level needed to run an experiment, lowers the barriers to access to experimentations, enables digital teaching, enables tailoring experiments to as a service, and having customized research as a service. And you can have this marketplace exchange of knowledge or of services on top of Pocket Science Lab, if Pocket Science Lab provides scientific tools to make experiments. So this is my vision for the integration of lab equipment on.
All right, thank you very much, Alessandro. Very nice to hear a different side of the open source. I think I'm gonna let go with one question, one very quick question. Harris, do you wanna ask your question?
Yeah, sure. Yeah. Alessandro, thank you for that talk. I got a question about how do you certify a particular equipment for use in, you know, like you do analysis of DNA or whatever. How do you ensure that this is actually accurate? How do you do the baseline? How do you do the calibration of these kinds of products so that they are comparable? They have, the results can be accepted by people who need the results.
Yes. For now, we are not that far for every lab equipment, for every device of the laboratory. I can tell you how do I do with the spectrometer. You usually take references which are cheap and available. In our case, the advantage of having these compact fluorescent bulbs, which are mercury lights, and they emit a spectrum, a rainbow, which is extremely precise. And when you correlate your reads with this spectrum, you are able to calibrate and to determine all the parameters of the calibration of your instrument. For example, accuracy, precision, resolution. And this is, so once you are able to produce these numbers, you are able to also to tell what you can measure. There is no certification actually at this stage we are just doing we are explicitly to our customers that we are doing it for scientific research, and everything has to be held as scientific research and is not meant to be used from a wide audience, but from a broad audience. But this is our goal, to go through all these steps about how do you calibrate an instrument, which is for lab usage. And I will already tell you, because it's something that it's possible to do, and there is, it's not, you just need the right tools. And how I do is to collaborate with institutions or partners who can actually certify and move me forward towards the certification institutions. Okay.
All right. I think we're out of time. Would you be available for some more questions in the discussion room? I think there's more interest on your talk. A lot of people excited about this different view of open source and open hardware.
I'm totally available. And so just let me check, how do I join the discussion room?
Yeah, you just
room?
Have to click on the left. There's a left, on the left, there's an arrow.
Yes.
That you can click and you will see the video rooms. Yeah.
Found it.
All right.
Okay, then
perfect.
I click it. I say goodbye to everyone. Yeah. And
thank you very
you
much,
can find the discussion room from here.